We can start with our first talk. The speaker here is Rüdiger Möller, Delta Juliet 1 Mike Romeo, and he is going to tell us about transmitter architectures for high efficiency amplification using PowerSDR software and the Hermes firmware. Please welcome Rüdiger Möller here.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me? Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Rüdiger. My call sign is DG1 Mike Romeo. Okay. I'm delighted to be here today to talk to you about a project I've been working on since the last few years together with Phil and Warren. My topic is transmitter architectures for high efficiency amplification. Okay. Ja, dann. Is this better? Ja, ah, okay. Nee, so, es geht gut. So, my topic is transmitter architectures for high efficiency amplification using PowerSDR software and Hermes firmware. Most of us using LDMOS power amplifiers or VMOS power amplifiers, some of you are using also tube amplifiers. All amplifiers we are using today have the same disadvantages. They dissipate heat. They have large heat sinks, increasing weight, and also expensive. So the question is there a chance to overcome these shortcomings using PowerSDR software and Hermes hardware? The efficiency of those amplifiers is at 50, let's say 60%, and most of the a part of the energy is dissipated in heat. So let us have a quick look at the modulation principles of the amplifiers. So the question is, can we use supply modulated transmitters? So let us take a look at the three modulation principles. The first I want to talk about is the envelope elimination and restoration, well known as Kahn technique. The second is the hybrid elimination and restoration technique, and my preferred method is the envelope tracking principle. If we have a look at the block diagram, we see that the SSB coming out from the Hermes will be split in two ways. One way goes over a delay line and an SSB limiter to the digital switched high performance amplifier. These amplifiers normally are realized in class E, class F, for instance, also in class D. The second way goes over a demodulator and in a buck converter. This envelope is transformed in the digital PWM. The digital PWM signal is then amplified by a class S amplifier, and a low pass filter filters out the baseband from the envelope. Injecting this envelope in the switched output stage will regenerate the original signal on the output. That's a shortly description of the envelope elimination and restoration principle. The second one I want to talk is the envelope technique. The envelope technique is a principle that uses a normal SSB input signal. We don't clip the amplitude information, and the power amplifier is a normal AB amplifier we all use. The task of the PWM is the same as in the EER principle. We have to consider that unfortunately the PWM low pass filter puts some delay in the signal path of the envelope. Normally for a four pole filter in Chebyshev or Butterworth, it would be between 6 and 10 microseconds. So it is very important that the envelope signal and the phase signal have an exact time alignment. We will see it on the next slide. Let's have let's take a look at the modulation schemes. We can see the red dashed color line is increases linearly, and this line we could use for EER and hybrid EER. Hybrid EER means that it's a combination of envelope tracking principle and EER principle. That means that with a hybrid envelope illumination and restoration principle, we are using the envelope tracking principle at lower modulation levels, and at higher modulation levels, we are using the EER principle. You can recognize that the starting point for envelope technique, for envelope tracking principle starts not from zero, rather than near the knee voltage of the MOSFETs. This has an advantage to avoid nonlinear behaviors caused by the capacities, caused by the nonlinear capacities in the output stages. Please keep in mind that the envelope tracking modulation line starts not from zero. So, providing an envelope, a powerful envelope signal on the supply modulated lines. I'm using pulse width modulation to realize this. And let's take a look how we generate the PWM. To generate the PWM from the directed envelope signal, we have to compare symmetric triangular waveform with the directed envelope signal, and then we get out from on a comparator a PWM signal that we can amplify in the power stage of with a class S modulator. If we take a look at the frequency domain, we can consider that the bandwidth we need for the digital PWM envelope signal is nearly 10 times more in contrast to the analog SSB 3 kHz PWM. Also, we can see we have around the switching carrier low sidebands and high sidebands, and also we have harmonic carriers with a low side and high sideband. This harmonics, I would say, we have to filter out with a low-pass filter. We can use, in this example, a 25 kHz filter. I'm using a 60 kHz filter to suppress these harmonics. How could we get the PWM signal without any electrical components? So, on the slide, we see on the left side a snapshot of the Hermes board near the Altera FPGA. And near the Altera FPGA, we can find jumper J14. And Phil provides on pin 2 and pin 5, pin 5 is a ground pin, the digital 3.3 volt PWM signal. I have decided not to directly use this PWM signal to protect the Altera FPGA. I'm using a little adapter board. This little adapter board contains an optocoupler and some voltage stabilizers. So on the left side, we have the 3.3 voltage envelope PWM, and on the right side, we have a 5 volt envelope PWM. This envelope PWM we have to connect to the input of the PWM, of the power PWM, via, you can use an USB cable or an Ethernet patch cable. It should be shielded. The circuit diagram of the little adapter board is very simple. The left side, we have the ingress side of the optocoupler, and on the right side, we have the egress side. Going to the PWM. It's not complicated. The optocoupler has the function to protect the Altera FPGA, I've said. So let's take a look at the PWM for a two-tone signal. On the left side, you see the regenerated 5-volt PWM signal for a two-tone. We can recognize the variable amplitudes of a two-tone, and we see two gaps. I will later explain these two gaps. If we give this digital PWM on a low-pass filter, we can generate the desired output voltage from the PWM. We can also recognize that this output voltage starts not from zero, rather than from the knee voltage. This waveform is usable for the envelope tracking principle. Now let's have a look at the menu of the PowerSDR software. I think many of you have seen the EER menu under the tab DSP, and I would shortly explain the functions of the menus. To provide the digital PWM signal, we have to activate the transmit EER mode. Also, if we are working in envelope tracking mode, we have to activate the amplitude modulation IQ signal. As I said, this is necessary to have exact a time alignment between the phase signal and the envelope signal. That's why we have the possibility to use this delay function from the PowerSDR software. And as I said, the low-pass filter unfortunately puts some delay in the signal path, and we have to compensate this with a phase delay. You see a value about 850 microseconds. This is, of course, the time to deliver this envelope signal takes some time, and you must correct this with this value. Another, I would say, a PWM control center, we can see on the right side, and there we have two input fields where we can modulate the output voltage. So let's take a closer look what happened if we change these values. On the left side, we see a modulation line, modulation voltage is usable for the EER mode. This voltage starts from zero voltage and up to the maximum. So you have to input a zero. The maximum value, the maximum input is 1023, but it is makes sense to have a little headroom for the buck converter I'm using. So I'm using a value near 1,000. And the regenerated PWM signal, envelope signal, shows as expected. In the second picture, we see that I have increased the minimum value, in this example, up to 200. That means that supported the generated power supply will not start from zero, rather than, let's say, 20 volts. You can fine-tune with this value the starting point. The other two examples have no meaning for our application. It shows what happened if we increase the minimum value to higher levels, and the other picture shows what happens if we decrease the maximum value. You can see that the maximum reachable power supply will decrease. As I said, it is very important to have time alignment between the phase signal you see on the button and the envelope signal. On the left side, you see an exact time alignment match between both signals, and a good starting point is to enter a value nearly near 800. It depends a bit from your Windows PC, and you can then vary the value and the phase delay to have an exact match. On the right side, you see what happens if the phase delay is not correctly. You can see there's no match, and that means the IMD3 values increase that we all wouldn't have. I have talked about the two principles, the EER principle and the envelope tracking principle. For the EER principle, we use a constant input SSB signal. This we could reach, I go back to the menu slide. If we deactivate this button, then we can get out from Hermes a constant phase signal without any amplitude information. You see on the zero crossing point a little bit overshooting, but that's a minor problem. On the left side, you see if what happens if we activate the amplitude modulation button, then we have the normal SSB output signal from Hermes. This signal we are using for the envelope tracking principle. The power stage of the class S modulator of the PWM. I'm using a class S modulator, a transistor and a freewheel diode are switching together and generating a rectangular impulse form on this point. With a low pass filter, we filter out the envelope signal. The width of the pulses is varied in proportion to the instantaneous amplitude of the desired output signal, which is recovered by the low pass filter. This class S modulators have a very high efficiency. I measured a value of about 95%. It is very good. So, in this slide, I'm showing you my circuit diagram for my second generation PWM modulators. A detailed description of this circuit diagram will be published in the German magazine called Funkamateur in the August heft, in the August magazine. I will not go in detail to explain this diagram. It is very easy. No adjustment element. We have the ingress driver. This ingress driver provides inverted and non-inverted PWM signal for the high side and low side driver. I'm using a Texas Instruments driver, UCC27714. And in the output side, I'm using for switching purposes the third generation CARBID MOSFETs from the company CREE. And on the low side for the tailbiter MOSFET also CARBID FET. The freewheel diodes I have realized with very fast Schottky diodes. On the output side, we can see the low pass filter. This dimensions of the low pass filter is usable for 100 volt power supply for a 1 kilowatt output amplifier. The next slide shows the impulses. The amplitude of these impulses is 100 volt, and it's very important to avoid overshooting on the rising and falling edge of these impulses. On the left side, you see the impulse form for an unmodulated carrier, and on the right side, you see the impulse form for a two-tone signal. You see the variable amplitudes. It's very very important to avoid this overshooting on this side and on this side. The next slide shows my a picture from my first prototype of the PWM. The dimensions are 75 millimeters, and on the right side, 160 millimeters. For the inductance course, I'm using RM14 with an air gap from 1 millimeter to avoid saturation effects. And on the left side, you see the little control board. This is shown on the next slide. It's very simple. The high side and low side driver and the ingress driver and the DC-DC converter for feeding purposes of the high side. This tiny PVM can drive my 1 kHz output amplifier as a two-stage amplifier with a gain nearly 40 dBs. That means 100 milliwatt input signal will provide 1 kilowatt output, and it's ideally for Hermes transceivers. I'm using 100 volt MOSFETs in this type VRF 3933, and on the driver stage I'm using VRF 148E. The main question is, can we reach with modulated powers, RF power amplifiers sufficient IMD3 values? This will shown on the next slide. You can see the IMD3 values with a power output from 750 watts, and we can reach nearly 60 dBs, and I think that is sufficient. A look of the amp view, we can see there's no memory effect on the correction line, and also we can see that the Mach amplitude and the Mach correction line have a wider distance. This is caused by the gain variation using a modulated power supply. If we would have unmodulated power supply, this both lines would be lying closer together. So. Main question is a helpful entry for beginners to get familiar with this principle. The answer is yes. The company CREE provides some two evaluation boards for buck converters. The first one is shown on this slide. It is a kit in 8020. This kit contains the two MOSFETs, also Capit MOSFETs, and the necessary gate driver modules. And the second one is a more comprehensive evaluation board, including the gate driver modules and with optocoupler to provide isolated inputs. If you use this evaluation board, you do not need a high side low side driver. This driver is here also integrated. Also, you can use the second evaluation board for full bridge converter. If you wish to provide power output levels, let's say 2 kilowatts, it's not possible to realize it with a buck converter. I prefer in this case a full bridge converter. Capit FETs. I'm using Capit FETs. These are very modern FETs from the CREE company, and they are delivered in different packages. One packet is very important. This is a 7L package. You can see 5 pins for the source contact, for the source pins, and an extra source pin for the gate circuit. And now, up June 2018, it is possible to buy the 4-pin package, and this power MOSFET can deliver 35 amperes and have an inner resistance up to 65 milliohms. So, the time is over. Are there any questions?
What is the overall efficiency that you can reach with this solution?
The overall efficiency is for an envelope tracking principle is 78%. That is normal. For the EER principle, you can reach over 90%. EER is a bit difficult to realize. Other questions?
With your IM3 measurements, were you using pure signal or not?
Yes, I'm using a pure signal. What we have to consider is the fact, if we this amplifier we have seen has an IMD3 value without any modulation by an output level from 750 watts, nearly 35 dB. It's normal and is well expected. If we use modulation, the IMD3 decreases, let's say, around 5 dB. So we have only 30 dB. Activating pure signals push it up to 60 dB. Without pure signals, this principle is not so good, I would say.
Is your efficiency frequency dependent?
Yes. The losses are increasing with higher frequencies. I have not shown the slides the slides I'm realizing E-class amplifiers and class EF amplifiers, and the efficiency of this switching amplifiers, saturated amplifiers, is very affected by the frequency, yes.
And how much is the decrease of efficiency?
Yes, it will be, let's say 80% for the switching amplifiers. It decreases. Yes.
Have you heard about results using this switching voltage technology on UHF and SHF due to the fact that transistors and FETs on these high frequencies are very sensitive for voltage changes due to the capacitance?
Yes, I have heard about this.
Results and the results?
I have tested this principles up to 20 meters.
20 meters?
20 meters. I can't say how it is up to 10 meters.
Yes, but not on SHF and VHF and the higher frequencies.
No, I have not tested it.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question on how do you find out the exact delay? You showed it is very critical, and you showed there are two values for it, but the question is, how do you determine it?
It's very easy. You have to connect the two channel, the two signals, the phase signal and the envelope signal, to an two-channel oscilloscope, and then you can vary the delay, and if the match is reached, you can expand the time line, and then you have reached the match, then you have found the value. But it is very important to have to change the frequency of the two-tone. I'm starting from 300 hertz up to 3 kilohertz, and then by all the frequencies, the match must be exist. It's very important. Otherwise, you can find a match, but in reality, it isn't a match. If you use one frequency, let's say 1.2 kilohertz SSB, two-tone, you can find a match, let's say, nearly 500 microseconds, and you think, oh, all thing is fine. No, all thing is not fine. You have really to figure out what is the correct value here.
Are you thinking of a method implemented in PowerSDR, how this can be done automatically?
No, I have not thinking so far.
It sounds a little bit complex to me at the moment.
I wouldn't say it. I have experience since the last 4 years, and I would say this is not complicated. There are no adjustment elements. You have to build the circuit diagram on the PCB, and it works. So it is. Further questions?
Any more questions? Yeah, moment.
Would the match be temperature related?
No.
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 So it's stable.
It's stable. You also must know that that we can tolerate mismatches up to 10 microseconds. Frederick Harab has figured out that values up to 10 microseconds mismatch is tolerable. You also can see it on the spectrum, in the IMD3 spectrum. If the left side and right side amplitudes are the same, the match is reached. Otherwise, you see different amplitudes in the IMD3 and IMD5 carriers. Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Rüdiger, for this interesting talk.